I'm going to talk about fruit. And one thing to keep in mind with fruit in the Bible is sometimes people have a one-dimensional view of fruit in the sense that is, you know, they'll say fruit is this, and then they'll have an idea of what fruit is, and then they'll try to apply it to every single verse in the Bible, which doesn't always work, because the fruit in the Bible can apply to many different things. And I'll go through five different types of fruit in the Bible today. It's a bit like leaven. You know, leaven in the Bible, you know, obviously it's a real thing that you know, uses to ferment things. And it's used as an analogy in the Bible to describe certain things and give you, you know, like an earthly example of something heavenly. And even in the Bible, leaven is different things. You know, leaven can be doctrine, leaven can be false doctrine, it can be sin, it can be different things. So if we just try and say leaven is one thing and try and apply it across the board in the Bible, it doesn't work. And it's the same with fruit in the Bible. So I'll go through just five different fruit in the Bible, give you a couple of thoughts. And hopefully this is a reminder for us as Christians, because obviously our purpose is to be fruitful, to glorify God in heaven. So we want to be as fruitful as possible in our Christian life. So the first one, obviously, is the actual fruit. You know, not as an analogy, but an actual piece of fruit in the Bible. And we'll just read in Genesis 1:9. It says, "And God said, let the waters under the heaven be gathered together unto one place, and let the dry land appear, and it was so." So this is the third day now. So he's creating the dry land and the seas, and God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together of the waters called he seas, and God saw that it was good. "And God said, let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed, and the fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth, and it was so. And the earth brought forth grass and herb yielding seed after his kind, and the tree yielding fruit whose seed was in itself after his kind, and God saw that it was good. And the evening and the morning were the third day." So we see here obviously the origin of fruit, because God is the creator of all. He also created vegetables and herbs and fruit. And just something interesting, because, you know, like even like my kids, you know, sometimes we'll be eating and they ask, you know, like where fruit came from. They ask where vegetables came from. And these sort of opportunities are always great to remind kids that, you know, God created these things, you know, and you can give them these answers. And we have the answers, as opposed to, you know, evolutionists. They don't know how it evolved. But, you know, I remember Simon just yesterday when I was driving to Ashton's place, he asked me why lemons were so sour. I mean, we don't know all the answers for these things. I don't know. But I know who created the lemon, right? And why he made it sour, I don't know. But at least we can remind them that God created these things for us to enjoy and to give us different flavors, right? Because if everything tasted the same, you know, if there weren't anything sour and everything was sweet, you'd get bored of sweet. So there's sweet, sour, salty. And what's that other flavor for steak? Does anyone know there's that flavor? What is it? No, it's salty as well, but it's like that charred flavor. Like when you char mushrooms and you char vegetables and you char like meat. Oh, it's on the tip of my tongue. But it's like a Japanese word. Because, what is it? Umami, that's right. Is it umami? I think it's umami. Where it's like the flavor when you like char grill something and it's got that extra flavor. Anyways, it was discovered by some Japanese guy. That's why it's got some Japanese name to it. Now, the earthly example of fruit, it teaches us some valuable principles, doesn't it? So that's why God, you know, has fruit the way it works, and he uses it as an example, because we can learn things from it. Because if we think about what makes fruit grow, I've sort of narrowed it down to three things. But number one, it's, you know, it requires the right environment, doesn't it, for fruit to grow. So whether it's, you know, the ground, what sort of ground it is, you know, usually it's in soil. You know, some trees grow better in sand, and some even grow better on rock. You know, there are some trees that grow on rock. You think about the space as well, the space that a fruit tree might need. You know, if they're too close together, they can be choked, or there's no light getting to it because it's too close to larger trees. Maybe the temperature, if it's too hot or it's too cold. I know that, like for a fig tree, for example, if you leave it out and it's freezing cold, the fig tree will die. You need to bring it in. It's just these different factors. And we can kind of apply these things to different areas of our spiritual life. You know, it needs the right nutrients. So it needs to be, have the nutrients to grow. And that can be fertilizers, you know, compost, dung. And some one thing I think about when you have to fertilize a tree, and you think of fertilizer, compost, and dung, what do you think? They're not very pleasant things. And sometimes in our life, things that aren't that pleasant have to happen to us, but yet it nourishes us and molds us, helps us to grow and be fruitful as well. So nutrients, they're not always pleasant, but they do us good. There's sunlight and obviously water. So that's one, requires the right environment. Number two is it requires work, doesn't it? So let's go to 2 Timothy 2. I'll show you a couple of verses. 2:6. Where it says here, the husbandman that laboreth must be first partaker of the fruit. So you can see here, it takes work, doesn't it? It takes work for a husbandman to dress a vineyard, to look after a garden, in order for it to be fruitful. It doesn't just happen on its own. And those of us who have tried to tend a garden, I know we've attempted and failed many times, but those of us who know, if you're good at a green thumb, you know it takes work, it takes consistency, you've got to do it every day, and if you don't, what happens? Your trees eventually die, or they get overrun with weeds, and or their fruit is not edible. You know, it can actually be bad for you sometimes. So it requires work. We can see that the husbandman labors. But not only that, it takes consistent work, doesn't it? I'll show you this passage in Proverbs 24. So Proverbs 24, we read about the field of the slothful. So the slothful man's field, where Solomon is walking by and he says here, I went by the field of the slothful. So the slothful is somebody who is lazy, right? And by the vineyard of the man void of understanding. So it's interesting there that being slothful and void of understanding kind of go hand in hand, like you know, you don't realize the problems with being lazy. And lo, it was all grown over with thorns, and nettles had covered the face thereof, and the stone wall thereof was broken down. So he sees this field of the slothful. He sees that because it's not being taken care of, it's got weeds all over it and thorns, so it's actually dangerous now to go in there and you can cut yourself. And the wall that enclosed everything in needs repairs as well. Then I saw and considered it well. I looked upon it and received instruction. So this is important that we learn from other people's mistakes. You don't always have to do something wrong in order to learn. Like this mentality of how do you know it's not good for you if you haven't tried it. I like what Ken Hovind says about that. He always says, well, go put your head under a truck and let the truck drive over your head. And they're like, well, I wouldn't like it. How do you know if you've never tried it? So you don't need to try things in order to know that it's bad for you, because you can learn from other people's mistakes. So you don't have to go and smoke to know that smoking will ruin your teeth, ruin your fingers, ruin your breath, and do all these things. You can learn from other people. In fact, at work, like I used to work with this guy, and he would smoke like a pack a day, and like his breath always smelled like smoke, his fingers were all yellow, and he even had like yellow stains on like his work chair, on his keyboard. It was like so disgusting. But yeah, that's what happens. I don't need to smoke to know that's a problem, right? I can learn from other people and the problems that they encounter. So Solomon here, the wisest man that ever lived, he doesn't have to be lazy in order to know the problems of being lazy. He can see the field of the slothful and he can consider it, you know, think about it. You know, don't just follow the crowd, don't just follow peer pressure, you know, whether it's uni or at school, don't be silly and just go with something just because everybody else is and you want to be cool. No, learn from your mistakes, learn from your parents, learn from people that have gone before you, that have done the mistakes, and attempt to not do those. So I looked upon it and received instruction. What does he learn? Yet a little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to sleep. So shall thy poverty come as one that traveleth, and thy want as an armed man. So number one, we see here that the slothful man, you see how he's making excuses, right? He's just saying, well, you know, it's not a big deal to him just to let it off week after week after week. It's a bit like that with church, with Bible reading, with prayer, with soul winning, right? You just make excuses. Oh, I'm just skipping 1 week. Oh, it's just been 1 month, and it's just been 1 year. Well, that's what the slothful person is like. He's just letting it go little by little. He's not being consistent, and therefore he's not being fruitful. Now his vineyard is all covered with thorns. And now how hard is it going to be to get that life back in order? So you think, hey, it's so easy just to skip church, skip your Bible reading, to the point where it's so difficult to get back into it. Do you know what I mean? So this is what this slothful person is like. He He's just making these excuses, and there's no consistency there, and as he lets it go, it's just eventually getting worse and worse. And it says here, "So shall thy poverty come as one that traveleth, and thy want as an armed man." So people that are slothful end up being poor as well, you know, because they're not working. And even people that don't take care of things, and maybe they got things going well, and then all of a sudden they hit bankruptcy, it's because they just let it slip. They think their business was doing well, but they weren't taking care of it. A little folding of the hands to sleep. And that often happens with large corporations, doesn't it? I don't know if you've sort of experienced it. When corporations are at the top, they kind of get complacent. And then all of a sudden, they realize they're going on the downturn, and then they end up going bankrupt because they can't turn it around. So people don't just get poor overnight. You know, it doesn't just happen. It doesn't just slap you in the face all of a sudden and just come. It's things that build up over time, and then eventually it's beyond repair. And then you find yourself maybe sleeping on the street because you didn't do anything about it previously. So we see here consistent work, isn't it? So it's not just work, because you know, it's easy to get things started, but it's not easy to keep going. Consistency, and especially in the Christian life. People start the Christian life. They start really well when it's all exciting, they're learning things new, but then how long do they keep at it? You know, this is why, you know, when you've been in the Christian life long enough and somebody gets in church, they get excited, they get going, you know, most people are like, hey, that's great. And it is great. You know, there's nothing wrong with that. But for those of us that have seen it happen, you know, been in Christianity long enough, you know, you're wondering, hey, is that person still going to be here a month from now? Is that person still going to be here a year from now? Is that person still going to be serving the Lord 5 years from now? And that's what I think is important, is that we are consistent and we keep going in the Christian life. Don't be a fly-by-night Christian where, you know, you get all excited and, you know, you get involved in everything and then 6 months later you're gone, never to return again. Consistent work. And you know, it's not just in Christianity, but even like in our personal life, in our work, either as an employee or as a business owner, this also glorifies God. If we're a hard worker, let me show you here in Ephesians 6, verse 5 says, "Servants, be obedient to them that are your masters according to the flesh, with fear and trembling, in singleness of your heart, as unto Christ." So this is the way God not only wants us to work in our spiritual life, be a hard worker, but this is how he wants you to work at your job as well, right? So at your job, what the Bible is teaching here is when we work at our job, we ought to work as though we are serving Jesus Christ. "Not with eye service as men pleases, but as the servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart." So you see, it's God's will. It's what God wants, is for you to work hard at your job. Not just when the boss is looking, right? "Not with eye service as men pleases, but as servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart." Because God is always seeing us. You know, we don't hide from God. He sees us when we are slacking off. "With good will doing service, as to the Lord and not to men. Knowing that whatsoever good thing any man doeth, the same shall he receive of the Lord, whether he be bond or free. And ye masters." So it's not just for employees, it's for people that are in charge as well. Whether you're a manager at work or whether you run your own business, you've got employees. You likewise need to work hard as well. "And ye masters, do the same things unto them, forbearing, threatening, knowing that your master also is in heaven, neither is there respect of persons with him." Because ultimately, even though you're an employee at work, or you're the owner at work, or you are a manager at work, you still answer. We all answer to the same boss. We all answer to Jesus Christ. So we ought to be all working as though we are part of one big business and the CEO is our Lord Jesus Christ. So we don't want to be slothful in business, like the Bible says. Not slothful in business. And that doesn't just mean like business, like work. Like business is meaning an activity. We shouldn't be slothful. Fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. So requires the right environment, requires work, so hard work, consistent work, not being slothful. But lastly, if we see here in James 5, that it requires patience. So in order to bring forth, for a garden to bring forth fruit, you know, we talked about like the right environment and ground and all that sort of nutrients, work to tend that garden. But then it also takes time, doesn't it? Because fruit doesn't just grow straight away. It takes time. And sometimes, like even I remember reading about fig trees where sometimes the first or second harvest you can't even eat. You got to go through a couple of seasons before you should even, you know, eat that fruit and things like that. I'm not an expert. I might be wrong on that. Don't hold me on that. But my point is, it requires patience, doesn't it? And we have to think about that in our spiritual life, where whether it's in our own life, you know, we need to go easy on ourselves in the sense that, you know, you may not know everything, you may not be as good as everything as you want to be in terms of Christianity, but give it some time. You know, hey, you're reading through the Bible the first time, you don't understand anything, but give it some time. You know, read it once, read it the second time, read it the third time. It's going to take some time before you start being fruitful in your Bible reading. Same with soul winning. Don't just go once or twice and then just think, oh, you know, this doesn't work. No, it's going to take some time. It's going to take some patience in the sense that you will try week after week after week, you know, and then eventually you'll start being fruitful. Are you hearing feedback? Is that why? I think you've got it a bit loud, Ashton. It's got some feedback coming back. So patience. So it's like that in your Christian life. You know, it's like that just in your job and, you know, dealing with people outside as well. But it's also dealing with other brothers and sisters in the church. You know, you want to be patient with other people. Those of us who have been longer in the Christian faith, sometimes we forget, and even I forget, that, you know, when I got saved, it wasn't till like a year and a half that I actually got serious. And actually, you know, the Lord got a hold of my heart and I decided I want to do something for the Lord. But imagine if, like, you know, people were just writing me off the first year and a half. And then I eventually just quit church because nobody was being loving. Nobody was being friendly. Nobody was being patient with me and just giving me some time to learn. So whilst I agree, hey, we provoke each other unto love and good works. You know, we want to encourage each other. We want to remind each other, hey, let's get in church. Let's go soul winning. Read your Bible. Hey, when there's something on, you know, encouraging people to get to it. But at the same time, we want to be patient with each other. You know, give each other time to grow in our spiritual life. Look what it says here. Be patient, therefore, brethren, unto the coming of the Lord. Behold, the husbandman waiteth for the precious fruit of the earth, and hath long patience for it until he receive the early and latter rain. So you see here that doesn't stop the husbandman from working, right? I mean, the husbandman's working, he's trying to get things going, he's trying to get this ground fruitful, and it's slamming church, you know, we're trying to provoke each other into love and good works. But at the same time, we understand that there's a part where God plays in it, where we plant or we water and God gives the increase, right? So whilst we encourage, we're also patient that God will give that increase and God will work in the lives of believers. He hath long patience for it, says here, in terms of waiting for that fruit to grow. So that's the first type of fruit, right? And sort of the lessons that we learn. I'm just going to cover a couple of thoughts on the others, because obviously the lessons apply to all the different types of fruit, but we'll give a thought to a few of them. So one is the actual fruit. Second fruit, so we'll go through five today. Second one is physical children, our physical daughters and sons. So let's go to Psalm 127. We'll see here that the Bible uses this phrase. Psalm 127. Okay. It says here in verse 3, "Lo, children are an heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward." So we see there that word fruit, because, you know, fruit is just, you know, reproducing, productivity. So when we reproduce physically, it's bringing forth children, isn't it? Now this is one of the commandments in Genesis. We'll go to Genesis 1. We'll see this here. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created him. Male and female created he them. So that's always an interesting point I stop on when I read this verse. It's interesting that man is created in the image of God, but not female, right? In the image of God created he him, because man is a male, just like God is our father. Male and female created he them. So females are not made in the image of God. That's why they look like females. You know, whereas we are made in the image of God, we look like men. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, Be fruitful, and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. Now, I just wanted to show you this verse in Acts 2 as well, Acts 2, verse 30, because not only does the, you know, obviously be fruitful and multiply, have children, and we got the fruit of the womb, so that's the lady, but then we also see this phrase here for the man, therefore being a prophet and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that of the fruit of his loins, according to the flesh, he would raise up Christ to sit on his throne. So we have being fruitful physically with children, and then for women, it's the fruit of the womb. For men, it's the fruit of his loins. Now let's think about when we talked about the actual fruit in terms of having physical children, because we talked about the environment, right, and the ground that it's in. So when I think about physical birth and being physically fruitful, the environment are things like your health, isn't it? So at the end of the day, you know, if you take care of these factors, you know, it's left up to God, because God ultimately gives the increase. Like with a fruit tree, right? You do the work, you try and tend to the garden, you give it nutrients, you take care of the environment, but ultimately God gives the increase. But there are things that we can do that can affect pregnancy, you know, that can affect giving birth, and we want to do all we can to not hinder God giving us children. So it could be, when it comes to our environment, it could be our healthy body. If you think about stress, you know, people that are often stressed, it's hard for them to give birth, because stress obviously takes a toll on your body and has health impacts. Or your weight. Often some ladies that are overweight, that shows as well that they're not, you know, in an ideal health, and that can affect whether or not they can get pregnant. Diet, the things that you eat, exercise. Also, it's the amount of seed you sow. Like, say, for example, you're trying to grow some trees, you would obviously sow more seed than you would want to give you a higher probability of getting a tree that's going to sprout. And it's no different with physical children. You know, the more a husband and wife sleep together, the more chance there is going to be for a seed to plant and fruit to grow from that. So stress, weight, diet, exercise. Sometimes the environment is cultural as well, where in a culture, if children are not valued, you know, if children are not valued in a culture, then, you know, people won't take the time to actually have children. You know, they won't want them. They would rather go chase a career, chase material possessions, rather than actually having children. But we know in the Bible says, watch out, profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul. So in the Bible, we know that children, a soul is more valuable than all the riches in the world. So if culturally somebody thinks material possessions or a career is more valuable than children, they do not have the same value system as God puts on children that says, you know, what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? You know, what possible thing in the world is worth giving up a child for if you are able to have more children? So sometimes it's the cultural environment where people are not fruitful physically, because, you know, either it's, you know, family pressures sometimes. I know coming from an Asian background, there's often family pressures for ladies to go to uni and chase a career and not be a mother, have less children in order to make themselves something. Whereas in the Bible, we know God's will is for a woman to bear children, guide the house, and give none occasion to the adversary to speak reproachfully. It's God's will for women to become mothers. Why? Because it's the most valuable thing there is. There is nothing valuable, more valuable than being a mother if you're able to be one. Because children are more valuable than anything that you could make out in the workforce. So that's the environment. What about work? When it comes to raising physical children, when I think of work, I think of the work it takes to have a good relationship with your wife. You know, the work it takes to raise children and have them disciplined so that they're actually a blessing. I mean, how many times do you hear people where they have one child and two children? They didn't put in the work to spend time with their child, have a relationship with their child, teach their child, discipline their child. They have two children. They're like, oh, I don't want any more children. I'm done with it. Because it wasn't a blessing for them. because they didn't put in the work to look after their family and actually be a blessing. But if you do look after your children and you do discipline them, they're a blessing to have, and you'll want more children. You'll see the joy that they have when they play with their brothers and sisters. You'll want to have more children. So that's what I think of when I think of the work. But also, it's a sign of the relationship with your wife. Because if you don't have a good relationship with your wife, you're not going to be lying together as often, and you're probably not going to be as fruitful physically as well, because there won't be as many opportunities, obviously, for the wife to get pregnant. So that's what I think about work when it comes to physical children. And patience is just, well, you know, obviously it takes time to get pregnant, doesn't it? You know, 9 months carrying the baby, and also, you know, children take time to make, you know, because you can't just have multiple at once, unless, you know, go do this Frankenstein stuff where you get IVF. You know, they go and they insert, like, you know, 8 babies. And that's why, you know, when you read these stories, I don't know if you realize, you know, when you read these stories, I think the most you could probably have naturally is maybe 3 triplets. We know, obviously, twins is possible, because in the Bible people had twins. But when you read these stories of ladies just having 8, 10, 12, 16 babies, you know, they're not having these naturally. Like, you got to understand that when you read the background story of these people, the reason why they've had so many babies in one go is because they've used in vitro fertilization, where they've, you know, harvested the eggs from the ladies. I'm not going to go into this, but basically, like, unnaturally just harvest all these eggs from these babies, from a lady, you know, overstimulate her ovaries. Then they basically fertilize them with the seed of man. And you know, we believe life begins at conception. So they're creating all this life. And it might be 16, 20, however many get fertilized. But because they're outside of the womb and it's not natural, some of them are, you know, all disfigured and don't grow properly. They just get thrown away. But the ones that they say are viable, the ones that are actually growing right, those get inserted into the mother. And because in vitro fertilization might be so expensive, they can't afford to do it multiple times, right? So they just want their best chance of having a baby, so they just put all the eggs into the mother. And sometimes all of them continue to survive, and eventually this lady has 8, 10, or 16, or whatever, however many babies they have. But it's not natural. This is not something that happens normally. This is something that only happens with in vitro fertilization, which has a multitude of ethical problems. So I would definitely, you know, discourage anybody that's thinking about doing in vitro fertilization. Research how it works, and it creates a lot of abortions, a lot of babies that are not able to survive because they're being fertilized outside of the womb. So it is something that should not be done, in vitro fertilization. So that's to do with our physical children. So patience. And sometimes when people don't have the patience to have children, they go and seek out these different medical interventions, and they don't realize the moral implications of it, because they just think there's nothing wrong with it. But research it. I've preached on it before, but I won't go into depth now. Okay, so that's number 2. So physical children. Number 3, we will get on to spiritual children. So not only physical children, where we actually, you know, sleep with your wife, you sleep with a lady, or sleep with a man, you have children and give birth to babies, but also spiritually, when we win people to Christ, the Bible calls that fruit as well. So Proverbs 11:30 is probably the famous soul-winning verse. The fruit of the righteous is a tree of life, and he that winneth souls is wise. This is why we call door knocking soul winning, when we're trying to witness to people, because we're trying to win people to Christ. We're trying to bring forth this spiritual fruit. And this is actually a principle throughout the Bible, where if you take part in getting somebody saved, you are almost like a spiritual parent to that person. Let me show you here in Colossians 4, a few verses there. Is that that verse? 14. I wrote the wrong one. Let me go to Galatians. Might be in Galatians 4:19. So this is Paul talking to the Galatians. He says, "My little children, of whom I travail in birth again until Christ be formed in you." I think it was Colossians. I think it's here somewhere. Unless I wrote the wrong verse. It says, not many fathers. Let me just find it quickly. I'm just going to, unless somebody knows. It's the one that says, you know, through Christ you have not many fathers. I've begotten you through the gospel. I just want to show you that one.
Is
Corinthians, that's why it's like Colossians 4, 15. Okay, cool. Yeah, this one. So this is where Paul is talking to the Corinthian church, and he says here, for though you have 10,000 instructors in Christ, so you have many people teaching you about the Bible, says here, yet have you not many fathers, for in Christ Jesus I have begotten you through the gospel. Wherefore I beseech you, be ye followers of me. So isn't that interesting that if you take part in actually getting somebody saved, or you're the person that gets somebody saved, you are like a spiritual parent to that person. You have given birth spiritually and begotten that person through Jesus Christ, like Paul is saying here, because he got the Corinthians saved. He's saying here, you know, you have many people teaching you the Bible, but yet I'm the one that got you saved. I begot you through the gospel. And obviously, you know, the spiritual picture is like parenting. Where it takes two parents to have a child. It's the same spiritually. It takes a father and a mother. It takes two parents. In terms of getting people saved, it requires a mother and a father, right? You've got the seed of God, but then you've also got the person who's giving the gospel. So it's not one or the other. It's not it's all God or it's all that person. It's both. We work together. We're in the yoke with Jesus, trying to be as fruitful as we can. Let's go on. So when it comes to spiritual children, when I think about the environment, I think about the parable of the sower. So let's go here to Mark, Mark 4, verse 14. And this is the explanation of the sower, right? The parable of the sower. It says, the sower soweth the word, and these are they by the wayside where the word is sown, but when they have heard, Satan cometh immediately and taketh away the word that was sown in their heart. So if you remember the parable of the sower, there's the four scenarios. The first one is the seed sown by the wayside. But what I want to point out to you here is, what is the ground in the parable of the sower? The ground in the parable of the sower is the heart, isn't it? So when we think about being fruitful spiritually, being fruitful in our Christian life, what is the environment, the good environment that we're trying to create? It's our heart, isn't it? That's one of the spiritual environments. What is your heart like? Is your heart right with God, or is your heart with the world? Now, the Bible says, if you love the world, the love of the Father is not in you. What is your heart like? What is in there? Because if you have a good heart, then you're going to be fruitful. But if you don't, then you're going to have these other hearts, aren't you? As we read through here. So the first one is when it's not even sown in the heart, right? It's sown in the heart, but then it's taken away by the devil. The second one, it's sown in the heart. It says here, and these are they likewise which are sown on stony ground. So this is a heart that is stony. And what does that mean? Who, when they have heard the word, immediately receive it with gladness and have no root in themselves, and so endure but for a time. Afterward, when affliction or persecution ariseth for the word's sake, immediately they are offended. So what is this? This is a Christian where their heart, they don't have a lot of understanding. It's not very deep. So they hear the word, but it just takes some persecution, people making fun of you, maybe people ostracizing you, people not wanting to hang out with you anymore, and then you just quit and get out of the race. That's the stony heart. What's the next one? And these are they which are sown among thorns, such as hear the word. So this is the thorny heart, isn't it? And the cares of this world, and the deceitfulness of riches, and the lust of other things entering in, choke the word, and it becometh unfruitful. So what's another reason why people are unfruitful? So one is that, you know, they're not even saved. That's the first scenario. The second one, they're saved, but they have no root in themselves. They don't learn enough. They're not deeply grounded in what they believe, so that when persecution comes, you know, when the sun comes up, they wither away easily. But what's this one? This is a heart of thorns, where either it's the cares of this world. This might just be a lot of worry. You know, sometimes we take on too much debt. Sometimes we take on too much work. And we're just always concerned about things that we just don't have time for God. You know, we don't have time to go sowing. If you find yourself saying that all the time, then you're too busy. You say, I don't have time for church. I don't have time for soul winning. I don't have time for Bible reading. See, if you're too busy to serve God, you're too busy. Right? Because that is what we're called to do. We're called to serve God. So that should come as priority. Not your job, not your business, not your family and those things. God comes first, and then we try our best to do those other things. We need to make sure God's things come first so that we are not unfruitful and have this thorny heart where the cares of this world are taking us away from what God has called us to do. The cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches and the lust of other things. So it's not just care and concern, but sometimes people are too busy chasing money, too busy with the riches, the deceitfulness of riches and the lust of other things, that they don't care for the things of God. They start to value things above valuing souls and getting people saved. And that's why they would rather work 6-7 days a week rather than work 6 days or 5 days a week and spend a day, you know, soul winning and going to church, because they're valuing things more than valuing the spiritual fruit. But look at this. But these are they which are sown on good ground, such as hear the word and receive it and bring forth fruit, some 30-fold, some 60, and some 100. See, so we're not all the same in the Christian life. Some of us are more productive than others because we have more talent than others. Some people put more time in than others. But you see here, if you have your heart right, you will eventually be fruitful. You see here, when there's the good ground, there's no some brought forth zero fruit. You know, everyone brings forth fruit when their heart is right with God and they're doing something for God. You know, you may not be the person that wins somebody directly, but just you getting involved, praying for the soul winning, going out with the person. You know, because there are often times, like, you think about it. Let's say me and Michael are together and we can only knock like one line of doors. But let's say two silent partners come along with us. And because of that, we're able to split up. And then somebody who was home only that day was on the other side of the road. So you see how you coming and us being able to split up, somebody got saved because of that. And that is attributed to you, you know, because you are part of that work. It's not only the person that prays with the person gets rewarded. It's everyone that's involved in that work. Whatever part you have, you will be rewarded for. So keep that in mind. Keep that in mind, your heart. The other thing as well is, so it's not just the heart, but in 1 Timothy 3:15, show you this. The Bible says here, but if I tarry long, Paul writing to Timothy here, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. So when I think of spiritual fruit, and we talked about your heart being right, but this is why church is so important, because church is not only the pillar of truth, so it upholds truth, and this is why it's so important that preachers preach truth, and when people come to church, they're not scared to preach the whole counsel of God. But another thing is, it's the ground of truth. It's somewhere that you can plug in, you can get rooted as like a tree in this garden, in the garden of God, and it's the ground in which you can flourish. And this is why it's so important for people to be in a good church. And those of us who have been in church long enough, you know that if you're in a church that's kind of dead, not really doing much, the members aren't really doing much either, because it's not really a ground of truth. You know, if you're in a church, they're doing good things, the truth is preached, and they're winning souls, you will grow along as well if you are just planted here. Because eventually, you'll either get out or you'll get on board with what's happening. It just might take some time, like we talked about that, patience with people. And sometimes spiritual growth takes patience, doesn't it? I got this verse here in 1 Thessalonians 5. Let me show you here in verse 14. Paul says here, now we exhort you, brethren, warn them that are unruly. So you see how that's something that's for all of us. It's not only for me to correct people that are unruly in the church. We ought to be warning each other, right? Like, if people are not doing the right thing, we have to keep each other accountable. It's not just me. It's not just my job to do that. I mean, everybody should be doing that. Warn them that are unruly. Comfort the feeble-minded. So us supporting one another and helping one another. It's not like when somebody's like having trouble, don't just think, oh, you know, Victor should take care of that. No. All of us have a job to play in the church to, you know, correct people that are wrong, but also help people that are in need. Support the weak. Be patient towards all men. So I just wanted to show you that, because even within the church, we want to be patient. Yes, we want to provoke unto love and good works, but we want to give people time to grow as well. Not be too hard on them. You know, be understanding, but at the same time, try and push them in the right direction. So that's spiritual children. So we had what? The physical fruit, spiritual fruit, physical children. And we'll do these last ones pretty quickly. But Galatians 5, we'll go to the fruit of the Spirit. So the fruit of the Spirit in a Christian's life. And this is, I think it's attributed to your work and the things that you exude from your spiritual life as you walk in the Spirit. So we won't read all, this is the works of the flesh, which is the opposite. But if you see here in verse 16, He says, "This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh." So how do you walk in the Spirit? To me, it's just one word. It's just obedience. You know, you walk in the Spirit because the Spirit is telling you the things you ought to do. You hear it, you know, and then you do it. That's what walking in the Spirit is. It's just obeying the Word of God. And if you disobey the Word of God, obviously it's sin, and that's the works of the flesh. But the opposite, if you obey the Word of God, you get the fruit of the Spirit. Now, the fruit of the Spirit is love. I don't have to explain that one to you. Joy, peace. What's long-suffering? Long-suffering is when you put up with things, right? You put up with things that are not comfortable for a long time. So you suffer a long time. Gentleness, being soft with people as opposed to being hard with people. Gentleness. Goodness is when you do the right thing. Faith is when you believe God's word. Meekness. Now, I always heard this phrase, you know, meekness is not weakness, right? So meekness is not just you letting everyone walk all over you. That's what people think Christians should be, right? They're just this soft person. Everyone can walk all over. They don't say anything. They never stand up for themselves or anything. No, meekness is not weakness. Meekness is, if you think about Jesus, right? Jesus didn't think it was robbery to be equal with God, so he knew he had the authority. He knew who he was, but yet he submitted himself where it was suitable, right? He knew his place on this earth, where he came to be a servant and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. And that's what meekness is. Meekness is knowing your position under God. It's like if you're an employee at work. You know, when your boss tells you what to do, you're meek when you know, hey, he is in authority. I'm the employee. So you go along with it. And you say, you know, even if your boss is ordering you around, you don't just, you know, have a go at him, you know, because that's his authority. That's her authority at work, where they have that authority, and meekness is, you know, submitting to the authority that is placed underneath you. That's how I understand it to be. And what's temperance? Temperance, as I understand it, is discipline. You know, when you do things, and going back to that consistency, isn't it? When you're disciplined in doing things, in season, out of season, that's when you're temperate, in the sense that you'll just keep going even though it's easy or hard, whether it's pleasing to do, you know, or it's not pleasing to do. Against such, there is no law. So when we are walking in the Spirit and we have the fruit of the Spirit, there is no law against these, saying like when you walk in the Spirit, you do the right thing. It's, you're not going to get the fruit of the Spirit when you're doing things that are sinful. And I'm just saying this because, you know, with this whole homosexual agenda, and they talk about love, and they go on about love, love, love. You're not going to get love when you're disobeying God, when you're fornicating, or, you know, when you're sleeping with the same sex, you know, man with man or woman with woman. That's not love, because there is a law against that. You know, like Leviticus 20 has laws against homosexuality. So homosexuality is not love, because the Bible says here that love, true love, there is nothing against that law. There is no law against that. It's the same with peace. Yeah, you can have peace when you get a divorce, but that's not the sort of peace this is talking about, because there's a law against just putting away your wife for any cause. So that's not the sort of peace. We want the long-lasting, the true fruit, which comes from walking in the Spirit and doing the right thing. Let's go on. So we got the first one was the actual fruit. Then we got the physical fruit of our children, the spiritual fruit of children by winning souls to Christ. We got the fruit of the Spirit. And the last one I'm going to cover today is in Hebrews 13. Let's go to verse 15. And we talked about this last week, where God loves to be praised, and that's a sacrifice that we can give him when we sing unto him and we praise his name in song. It says here, "By him therefore let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually, that is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name." So we see another type of fruit in the Bible. So we see the actual fruit, physical fruit, kids. We see the fruit of the Spirit, which, you know, is sort of intertwined with our works and things like that, the things that we do and the way we walk in the Spirit. The last one is, it's the things that we say. So when we think about being fruitful, I just want you to keep all these different fruits in mind. Not only does God want us to work hard, he also wants us to have a lot of children. He wants us to have a lot of spiritual children. He wants us to walk in the Spirit and have a lot of fruit of the Spirit, but also he wants us to have a lot of fruit that we say as well. That's why he wants you to sing. He wants you to praise him. He wants you to thank God. You know, when you talk to your children, he wants you to talk about him. Things like that. He wants you to use your mouth to praise the Lord, the things that you say. Now, all the same rules apply in terms of being fruit. So I'm not going to go over them again, you know, in terms of the environment, the work, and being patient, you know, allowing people to grow as they change the way they talk. And that's something you ought to think about as a Christian, is how do you talk? You know, do you talk like the world? I think as Christians, we ought not be talking like Hollywood, where we're just swearing all the time and telling dirty jokes and things like that. Now, I'm not saying that swear words in and of themselves are wrong, but we ought to think about how we represent God. You know, on this earth, we represent the King. Now, if your boss sends you on a work run to go represent somebody, do you just go there dressed however you want? You're just like, hey, my homie, and you F this, F that, S this, S that? No, right? Because you're representing somebody. You wouldn't just do that just in your normal life. But yet, when it comes to your everyday life, you don't think about, hey, you're an ambassador for Christ, how you behave, how you talk. Hey, that's how you are representing Jesus on this earth. You need to think about that. And just think about how you present yourself, how you talk to people, how you treat others, because that is going to reflect on our God. And it's a very high calling. You know, when you're an ambassador of a country, hey, we are here as ambassadors of the heavenly country for our, you know, president or king, Jesus Christ. Now, I want to end on this point, because when it comes to the fruit of our lips, I just wanted to go to Matthew 7, because, you know, this is often a passage that is widely abused to talk about your assurance of salvation. And let's read it, just Matthew 7 to verse 15. And I think the fruit that it's talking about in this passage is actually the fruit of our lips, and that's why I'm going to end on this point. And I'll show you a couple of reasons why I believe that. But Matthew 7 verse 15 says, "Beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. Ye shall know them by their fruits." So isn't it interesting? Whenever you talk to people about salvation, and you talk to them about assurance of salvation, like how do you know you're saved? How many people have quoted this passage and say, well, you know, the Bible says you'll know them by their fruits, so that's how you'll know you're saved. But is that even the context of this passage? I mean, verse 15, it says, "Beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing." Now, not every unsaved person is a false prophet. And saved people are not false prophets. Do you know what I mean? So this is what it's saying. And it says, "You shall know them by their fruits." So you can't just make the "them" mean anything you want, right? And just say, "Oh, you'll know them by their fruits," and just say that's Christian. No, because the context of this passage is saying, how do we identify false prophets? But sometimes people will take this principle and say, oh, the tree is known by its fruits, and then they'll apply it to assurance of salvation. And I'll show you why this is a wrong application of this passage. And we'll read on. Ye shall know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles? Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. So this is where they talk about, you know, well, you know, if you don't have the fruit, then you're not saved and you're going to go to hell. So you need to make sure, you know, you've got the works and things like that. Wherefore, by their fruits ye shall know them. So remember, what is the them? The them is false prophets in this passage, right? But let's say, even if somebody would say, oh, I know it's talking about false prophets, but are we just taking the principle of a fruit identifying the tree? Yeah, that's fine, but see, it can't be talking about assurance of salvation for the Christian. Why? Because as Christians, we still sin, don't we? I mean, Christians are not sinless. Why? Because we have the flesh and the spirit. We have the flesh, and that's why sometimes we walk in the flesh. And we have, according to this passage, or according to how they would interpret it, bad fruit. But what does this passage say about the two trees? It says here, if a saved person is a good tree and an unsaved person is a bad tree, look at what it says. It says a good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit. So what Jesus is teaching here is that the good tree brings forth good fruit, and a good tree can't bring forth bad fruit. Only the bad tree brings forth bad fruit, and a bad tree can't bring forth good fruit. So if somebody is applying this to the Christian as a whole and using it as a basis of assurance of salvation, what would that actually show? Does that show I'm saved? No, that would actually show I'm not saved, right? Because I still have bad fruit, I still sin. And if the verse is saying a good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, Doesn't that mean I'm a bad fruit, a bad tree, by that definition? So you see how, like, you can't use this for assurance of salvation in regards to your works, because if it was, as the Christian as a whole, either the Christian is a good tree or a bad tree, then we would all be bad trees, right? Because the bad tree brings forth bad fruit, and we all have bad fruit if fruit is our works. And none of us only bring forth good fruit. So we can't just say the good tree is a saved person and a bad tree is an unsaved person. So how do we understand it? Well, it's because we have both. We have the spirit and the flesh, right? So the way I understand it is the good tree is the spirit. It's the spirit that's born of God that cannot sin, but the bad tree is the flesh. And if you walk in the flesh, like we read in Galatians 5, you fulfill the lust of the flesh and it'll bring forth that bad fruit. But I don't even think, you know, you can take that principle and, you know, it kind of fits in the sense that, you know, if we understand it that way, we understand that a Christian has both natures, right? It has a good tree and a bad tree. But we're not using it as a basis for assurance of salvation, because if it did, it doesn't offer us any assurance. You know, we have assurance of salvation because we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and the Bible says, "These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God." That's how I know I have eternal life. You know, it's not from my fruit. It's because I believe, you know, and the Bible says I can know I have eternal life. That's why I know I'm saved, because the Bible says I'm saved. So how do we understand this passage? Now, what is this fruit? Now, obviously, some people think that this fruit is talking about your actions. Now, I don't believe it's talking about your actions. Why? Because, let me show you a couple of verses here. Ephesians 4:14. Why do I not think it's saying that you'll identify a false prophet by their actions? Well, number one is because, remember in that passage, I don't know if we read it. Yeah, we did read it. You know, he says, they come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they're ravening wolves. So how do you think you're going to identify a false prophet by how they behave if they're in sheep's clothing? Right? They're deceiving you that way. Like, same within Ephesians 4. It says here that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. You see, a false prophet is not trying to look like a false prophet. He's not like dressed in red with horns and a pitchfork, and then he's, you know, trying to preach you the truth, trying to preach you lies. No, he's a wolf in sheep's clothing. And even when you look at the Pharisees, I'll show you here in Matthew 23:27, he says here, "Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For ye are like unto whited sepulchres, which indeed appear beautiful outward." So you see, when you look at these Pharisees and scribes, they look like they're doing, they look beautiful, they look clean, they look like they're being righteous, but are within full of dead men's bones and of all uncleanness. Even so, ye also outwardly appear righteous unto men. So you see, they're going to appear righteous. They're not going to appear unrighteous. Right? So this is why you can't know them by their fruit of the way they act, because they're going to appear righteous. But within you are full of hypocrisy and iniquity. So this is why I think, you know, false prophets, they appear in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they're ravening wolves. So I don't think we can identify them easily by the fruit being their actions. Now, this is why I think the fruit that it's talking about in Matthew 7 are the things that they say. It's the fruit of your lips. It's the fruit of their lips where you can tell that they're a false prophet. And I'll show you a couple of verses why I believe that support this idea in Matthew 7 that the fruit is the words that they speak. Now, if you remember in Matthew 7, we'll just go back there quickly because I just want to show you. He says, "Ye shall know them by their fruits." And notice this, "Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles?" So if you think about it, when you're trying to gather fruit from people, you're not trying to gather their actions, right? Like usually, like I'm thinking you're gathering knowledge from them, right? So you're trying to gather something from them. That's how I sort of fit it there. But I want you to notice here the two fruits that there are. So he's saying, do you gather grapes or figs, right? From thorns or thistles. Now look at this verse in James 3. And if you're not familiar with James 3 is the passage that is about the tongue. You know, it talks about, you know, we offend all, and it says the tongue cannot be tamed and that sort of thing. So that's the context of James 3, the things that we say, right? Because talk about taming the tongue. The tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body and setteth on fire the course of nature, and is set on fire of hell. For every kind of beast and of birds and of serpents and of things in the sea is tamed and hath been tamed of mankind, but the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. See, this is why we have to think about the things that we say, right? Because the tongue is a very, very powerful tool. It can be used to build up, or it can be used to completely dash people and just break them. Therefore bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not so to be. Doth a fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? Look at this. Can the fig tree, my brethren, bear olive berries, either a vine figs? So just seeing back there with the figs and the vine. Well, this is an olive vine, but the other one was grapes. But trying to show you the link there, that in Matthew it talks about gathering grapes and figs, whereas here as well it's talking about us talking, and it's talking about that fruit of our lips either being figs or, you know, berries. You know, which one's going to be? So can no fountain both yield salt water and fresh. So that's one reason why I think, you know, even in James, when it's talking about the tongue and the things we do, it relates it back to fruit on a tree. Let me show you another one. Matthew 12, verse 31. Now again, the context here is about blaspheming the Holy Ghost, the things that we say, right? What they blaspheme with their mouth and speaking. But look at this. This is interesting, because this really puts it in perspective. Wherefore I say unto you, all manner of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven unto men, but the blasphemy against the Holy Ghost shall not be forgiven unto men. And just notice how it's about blasphemy is what you say, right? Whosoever speaketh a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him. But whosoever speaketh against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven him, neither in this world, neither in the world to come. So again, it's about what's being said, right? Now look at this. Either make the tree good and his fruit good, or else make the tree corrupt and his fruit corrupt, for the tree is known by his fruit. So again, so you're talking about what we say, the blasphemy, and then he says, hey, see the good tree and the bad tree brings forth good fruit, bad fruit. It's what we're saying. O generation of vipers, how can ye, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. So again, see that the heart being that ground, your mouth is bringing forth words, bringing forth the fruit of your lips, and it's either good fruit or bad fruit. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. And look at this. But I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. So you see that whole context there is about blaspheming, speaking evil things. Then he says, make the tree good or make the tree bad. And then he says here that, you know, out of the abundance of your heart, you bring forth good or evil things. And then he says, your words are what are going to judge you on the day of judgment. So you see how it just sort of ties it all together, why I believe, you know, that it's the words that the false prophets are saying, that's how you know that they're false prophets. And why false prophets? Because unsaved people say all sorts of silly things, right? Or even just saved people might say false doctrine. But why is he saying you'll know a false prophet? Because if somebody actually gets up and tries to teach you something, teach the word of God, they're not just saying things willy-nilly anymore. Like up here, like I'm not just up here like ad-libbing. Like I've planned this sermon. Like, you know, I've planned the notes. I'm thinking about what I'm wanting to communicate with you. And that's why it's with prophets. You'll know a false prophet by the things he says, because when they get up and they preach, that's calculated what they're actually trying to teach you. And if they're teaching something false on a stage where they've prepared the message, they've obviously thought about it. It might not even have been the first time they've taught it. That's why you can identify a false prophet by what they say, because what they say is probably what they believe, right? Because they planned that sermon out. Let me show you just one other example. I won't go to both, but if you remember in Matthew 3 and Luke 3, where the Pharisees went to John, and he says, and we're about to confessing this, but when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to his baptism, he said unto them, O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bring forth therefore fruits meet for repentance. So people often will link that up with Matthew 7 and say, oh, see the fruits you've got to bring forth to show you're saved. But I still think this is talking about what they say, right? The fruits that they should bring forth meet for repentance, meaning if you're actually saved, why do you teach all this wrong stuff? You're still saying that Jesus, oh, you know, that whatever, like it's by works or whatever, what they're saying. But look at what they were saying. What they were saying that was wrong, that was not meet for repentance, and think not to say within yourselves. So remember how he says, bring forth fruit meet for repentance, and then he says, don't say this within yourself. We have Abraham to our father. For I say unto you that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. So what were they saying? What was their fruit that wasn't meet for repentance? Oh, we're going to heaven because we're Jews. You know, because we're children of Abraham. No, we don't have to believe on Jesus Christ. We don't need a Savior. We just are because we are born of the seed of Abraham. That was not fruit meet for repentance, because fruit meet for repentance is, hey, I believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. That is fruit meet for repentance. Fruit meet for repentance is, I'm not good enough to get myself to heaven. I need a Savior. So that sort of sheds some light on that too, I think. So the other thing that people might think Matthew 7 is talking about is talking about either the false prophets' physical children or their spiritual children. Now, the reason why I don't think that sort of helps you, because how then do you judge the physical child or the spiritual child? Do you know what I mean? Because if you know a false prophet by their disciples or their children, obviously then you have to judge the child, either the spiritual child or the physical child. And the only way you're going to do that is either by their actions or by their words. And we already talked about actions, right? Actions, they might be living right, but that doesn't mean they're teaching right, right? So even if you were to judge their fruit physically or spiritually, you would still have to judge what their disciples are teaching. And it's probably what the false prophet is teaching anyway, right? So you could just judge the false prophet by the fruit of his lips. Okay, that's it. Anyways, I hope that was interesting. Five different fruit in the Bible. So let's not have a single dimension of fruit in the Bible. And, there is different fruit. But ultimately, the Bible says here, herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit. So shall ye be my disciples. So our goal in our Christian life is to be as fruitful as possible in all the areas of fruit and just beware of the things that don't make us fruitful, right? The lust of this world, the lust and cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, and also having the cares of this world, as well as not knowing what you believe, not creating that environment, number one, at church, and number two, in our heart. All right, let's pray. All right, thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you for the reminder to be fruitful. And we pray, Lord, that you would help us to be fruitful in all areas of our life. And Lord, we need your grace. We need your strength. We need you to help us to, bring to our attention things that are stopping us from being fruitful. And I pray, Lord, that this church would be a good ground of truth for people to grow and flourish. But Lord, also help us to prepare our heart so that our heart would be a good ground, so that we hear your word. That word would not be wasted, and Lord, it would grow and be fruitful. Thank you, Lord, for using us. We are not worthy of your love. We're not worthy of being your servants. But pray, Lord, that you would continue to help this church to grow and use us and multiply the seed that we're trying to sow in this neighborhood. Thank you, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.